Hello everyone. The topic is pre-prosthetic surgery for today. So what is prosthesis? It is the replacement of the missing teeth and the oral and maxillofacial tissue with artificial substitute. There remains like a significant number of patients who can never be made to wear dentures effectively. Why? It is because they may be having bone atrophy or they may be having soft tissue hypertrophy, localized hard or soft tissue problems. And in this patient, pre-prosthetic surgery, it offers a significant contribution. Pre, it means before, prosthesis, that is this prosthetic, it is nothing but fabrication of prosthesis. So pre-prosthetic is, we are doing some surgeries before the fabrication of prosthesis. For example, in complete denture. So over here, this is a completely edentulous arch. So for complete denture, Goodsell, he has recommended criteria for healthy and ideal edentulous ridge. And the ideal edentulous ridge, it should be like, it should have adequate bony support. It should have adequate soft tissue covering the bone. Then there should be no undercut, no bony or soft tissue protuberance. The ridges, they shouldn't be sharp. Then there is no frenum or muscle fibers, which is dislodging the prosthesis. And there should be adequate sulcus depth. Then the next is, there should be a proper relationship between the maxillary and the mandibular arches. So basically, if there is problem in any one of this criteria, pre-prosthetic surgery, it is required in such cases. So the main objective of pre-prosthetic surgery is to provide a better anatomic environment and to create proper supporting structures for denture construction. So that when you fabricate a denture, it should have proper retention, stabilization, peripheral seal, and it should fulfill all the needs. Why are you fabricating a denture? It's basically for mastication, speech, aesthetics, etc. And the ultimate goal, it should be the rehabilitation of the patient. And to achieve this goal, we are doing this pre-prosthetic surgeries in those particular cases. As the denture fabrication is dependent on taking support from all these tissues which are present. So in complete denture, we are taking support mainly of this alveolar ridge. So if there are any problems with the alveolar ridge, we need to do pre-prosthetic surgeries. So what is pre-prosthetic surgery? It is carried out to reform or redesign the soft and hard tissue by eliminating the biological hindrance to receive a comfortable and stable prosthesis. So it is usually redesigning or reforming the hard and the soft tissue. If any of them is creating problems or hindrance to receive a comfortable and a stable prosthesis. To reform or redesign denture bearing areas to create an oral environment to support a functional and aesthetically acceptable prosthesis. The surgical procedures, they are undertaken to modify the anatomy of ridges to facilitate the retention of the denture. So for example, if the ridges, they are resorbed, too much resorbed, in that case you won't get retention. So we are undertaking such procedure, surgical procedure, so that we can modify the anatomy of the ridges to facilitate the retention of the denture. So what are the aims of pre-prosthetic surgery? First is to conserve the oral structure, to provide tissue to withstand the masticatory forces and to achieve functional aesthetics. So basically it is conserving the oral structures. And the main use of, like, why people are getting their prosthesis done, it is basically to have that proper mastication and aesthetics, speech. So to withstand the masticatory forces, we are using, like, the aim of pre-prosthetic surgery is to withstand that masticatory forces. The next one is to provide optimum ridge in terms of height, width, and the contour adequate bone support. So if the ridge is resorbed, then in that case, we are providing the optimum ridge in terms of height, weight, width, and the contour adequate bone support. Then the next is to provide adequate soft tissue support establishment of the correct vestibular depth. So this is like the vestibular depth. So now when you are fabricating a denture, you are seeing the vestibular depth. If the vestibular depth is not appropriate, if it is shallow, then you need to do the pre-prosthetic surgery to get that correct vestibular depth. The next is elimination of a pre-existing bony deformities. If there are tori presence or if the myelohyoid ridge, So over here, this is the myelohyoid ridge. If it is prominent or there are presence of genile tubercles, in that cases, you are doing pre-prosthetic surgeries to eliminate them, because the denture, it won't sit properly on such cases. Like if your myelohyoid ridge, it is prominent, so your denture, it won't be retentive or it won't be stable in such cases. The next is correction of maxillary and mandibular ridge relationship. Correction of maxillary, then elimination of the pre-existing soft tissue deformatives. So if there are any soft tissue deformative like epulis, flabby ridges or hyperplastic tissue, epulis is nothing but enlargement. So this one, if there are enlargement presence, then enlargements, usually epulis is nothing but enlargement which are situated on the gingival or the alveolar mucosa. So in such cases, you are doing pre-prosthetic surgery. So over here, this was the mandibular tori. If in such cases, you cannot like get a good prosthesis, so in that case, you need to do pre-prosthetic surgery. The next one is relocation of frenum or the muscle attachment. In some cases, you will see the frenum is attached highly. In that cases, there will be diastema or it would create problems and it requires pre-prosthetic surgeries. Then the relocation of the mental nerve, lateralization of inferalveolar nerve, and if there are undercuts present, then we are removing it through pre-prosthetic surgery. So these are the aims of pre-prosthetic surgeries. The classification is, it depends upon the, so it is divided into hard tissue and soft tissue. Hard tissue is your alveolar ridge. So it is divided into four again. So first is alveolar ridge preservation. You are preserving your alveolar ridge. The second is alveolar ridge augmentation. So augmentation is nothing but the process of making greater in size or amount. So if your alveolar ridge is to resorb, so you are augmenting it. So you are increasing the size of it. And it is subdivided into mandible and maxilla. So the procedure which are performed in mandible are superior border augmentation, inferior border augmentation, visceral osteotomy, interposition bone grafting. So basically you are like doing the grafting procedure to increase the size. Then in maxilla, only bone graft, interpositional bone graft, sinus lift. So these all are the procedures which are done in alveolar ridge augmentation. The next is alveolar ridge correction. So in that, there is primary alveoloplasty, secondary alveoloplasty. If there are any tori, so excision of tori, myelohyoid ridge reduction. If there is prominence of myelohyoid ridge, then genial tubercle reduction, maxillary tuberosity reduction, tuberoplasty. Orthognathic surgery is segmental and total jaw. In soft tissue, there is phrenectomy, vestibuloplasty or ridge extension procedure. If the vestibular depth is shallow, that is the vestibuloplasty in which you are increasing the height. So increasing that height of the vestibule. Then reductant tissue excisions and mental nerve repositioning. So over here it is alveolar flabby ridge. Then denture granuloma if there is presence of epulous fistulatum. So in all these cases you are doing this pre-prosthetic surgery that is termed under the soft tissue. So starting off with the first, that is the alveolar ridge correction. In that there is alveolectomy. That is, it is the surgical removal or trimming of the alveolar process. It is known as alveolectomy. So clinically, so basically it is like removal or trimming of the alveolar process. So your alveolar process, it is trimmed or removed and that is known as alveolectomy. So clinically, after extraction, whenever there is presence of sharp margin, so basically after removing the tooth, so after extraction, you'll see in some cases there will be bony spicules which will be there. Or there are sharp margins. So the alveolar ridge will have a sharp margins and they will be irregular at interdental, interseptal or labiolingual alveolar crest. And because of that, they should be trimmed with a ronger or a round burr and they are smoothened with a bone file. So this is a ronger's forceps. Basically, it is used to trim the bone and with bone file. Now, after trimming it, so it is roughened. So you are smoothing it with a bone file. So the trimming of the alveolar process, it should be carried out properly. So care is taken, only a minimum amount of area it should be trimmed because we don't want too much of the leg bone to be removed because our denture, it takes the support of your main alveolar ridge only. So too much bone loss will result into poor denture base. So this is the Ronger's forceps and this is single tooth alveolectomy and alveoloplasty. Alveoloplasty. Alveoloplasty, it refers to the surgical recontouring of the alveolar process. So you are recontouring. So basically, if so, in this case, now you can see This is a smooth alveolar ridge. In this case, you can see how irregular there is this sharp alveolar ridge or alveolar process which is present. So in that cases, you need to do alveoloplasty. So the contouring, it is done with the purpose to take care of the bony projection or if there are sharp crestal bone or undercuts. So a well-contoured, smooth ridge is essential for proper construction of denture. If your alveolar ridge, it is irregular, so in that case, you won't get that good denture or it won't be stable or it won't be retentive. So you need a well-contoured, smooth ridge. While contouring the ridge, it is highly essential to remember that greater the excision, greater will be the resorption. So you should be careful and you need to remove the amount that much is required, not more than that. Hence, it is limited to contour the sharp irregular ridges and unfavorable undercuts. Minimum amount of resorption, it occurs if simple extraction. If after simple extraction, what you're doing is digital compression of the alveolar cortices is done, immediately is the simple compression alveoloplasty. So basically, when you remove your tooth, after that you're compressing it. So that is the simple compression alveoloplasty. So the crest of the bone, as you know, this is the crest of the bone. It surrounds the tooth. And if it is irregular, we need to do this procedure, that is alveoloplasty. So what are the goals of alveoloplasty? First one is to provide the optimal ridge contour. So basically, we are doing alveoloplasty to get that optimum ridge contour. The second is the alveolar ridge. It should be left as broad as possible. So we should not do the alveoloplasty such that the ridge, it gets narrow. Because if it is broad, then there is this maximum distribution of the masticatory forces. The ridge, it need not be perfectly smooth, but the sharp irregularities, it should be removed and the edges, it should be rounded. So it's not like you want this ridge to be perfectly smooth, but only these sharp irregularities which are present, they should be removed. The mucosa which is covering the ridge, it should have uniform thickness, density and compressibility. In younger patient, less amount of bone, it should be removed as the process of resorption, it extends for longer number of years than the older patients. So we have to take care in younger patient that we are removing less amount of bone. So the first is the simple conservative alveoloplasty. So if multiple adjacent teeth, they are extracted in a single setting, then the simple alveoloplasty technique is advocated if there are no bony irregularities present. So if there are multiple teeth extraction in a single setting, in that case, if there is no bony irregularities, then you're doing the simple conservative alveoloplasty. Immediately after extraction, the buccal and the lingual place, it should be compressed with firm digital pressure and the gingival tissue, it is repositioned and the entire ridge is palpated for locating sharp bony spicules and undercut. So basically, this is what you do after extraction. You're compressing the buccal and the lingual plates with a digital pressure. So this is what you do in simple conservative alveoloplasty. The next is the primary alveoloplasty. It is used to describe the trimming and removal of the alveolar bone, which is carried out at the time of extraction of the teeth. So primary alveoloplasty is done at the time of extraction of the teeth. So indication, if the patient, they have dense and prominent alveolar bone and it is done as a procedure prior to the construction of immediate denture. So in some cases, you need immediate dentures. So before it, you do this primary alveoloplasty at the time of extraction only. So what is the technique? So first what you do is a crevicular incision, it is placed along the free gingival margin. So this is a crevicular incision along the crevices of the bone, crevices of the tooth. So basically it's near the gingival margin. And a full thickness mucoperiosteal envelope flap or a triangular flap is elevated. So this one is the envelope flap and this is a triangular flap. So first you're taking an incision, crevicular incision, then you're raising a full thickness mucoperiosteal envelope flap or a triangular flap, which extends up to one tooth distance on each side of the socket. So if there's this socket, for example, if a socket is present over here, so it should extend like up to one tooth distance. So your incision or your flap, it is raised like this only. It is elevated and it is extended up to one tooth distance on each side of the socket. The next is a sharp cutting Ronger forceps. It is held with one beak beneath the bony rim of the socket and the other on the crest of the ridge. This is a Ronger. So what you're doing is you're holding it. So these have these two beaks. So this Ronger, it has two beaks. So one beak it is beneath the bony socket, bony rim of the socket, and one is on the crest of the ridge. Then small pieces of a required bone, of the required amount of bone, it is removed, and the bone file is used to smoothen the bone. So first you do this incision, then you raise a flap, then you take this Rogers forceps and you cut how much the bone is to be removed, and after that you're doing smoothing of the bone with the bone file. Then the mucous membrane is then held with the sutures. Then you are doing the suturings. And if any excess flap is present, it is trimmed and the edges are approximated. In case of immediate dentures, the previously prepared template, it is fitted on and noted for the presence of any pressure points. So you have, like in the cases of immediate dentures, you have prepared templates. So you have prepared that impressions. And then they are fitted on this after this primary alveoloplasty, and after that you are seeing for the pressure points, and which is indicated by blanching of the mucosa under the transparent acrylic plate template. If they are present, they should be trimmed again. In cases of severe periodontitis, alveoloplasty should be done 4 to 6 weeks after multiple extraction. So in severe periodontitis case, you are doing alveoloplasty after 4 to 6 weeks. The next is this Dean's intraseptal primary alveoloplasty. It was given in 1936 by Deans. So it is used in maxilla only, mainly in the anterior region. So you're using this procedure in maxilla. The procedure, it involves preparation of 6 anterior teeth, and sometimes the premolar are included. So this is involved preparation of 6 anterior teeth. So according to Dean, most posterior teeth, it should be removed first to preserve the integrity of the labial cortical plate and to avoid any disturbance to the blood supply. So this is basically what you do at the time of extraction. You're removing the posterior teeth first. So what are the indications of Dean's? First, it is used to reduce gross maxillary overjet. If there is gross maxillary overjet present, basically if your maxillary, they are more way ahead and it creates gross overjet, in that case, you're doing this Dean's primary alveoloplasty. The next is, it is carried out at the times of multiple teeth extraction or early initial post-extraction period. If you are extracting multiple teeth, so in that case, you are doing this Dean's intraseptal primary alveoloplasty. Then it is indicated in the cases where adequate bone height exists, but an undercut is present on the buccal aspect of the alveolar, of the maxillary ridge. So what are the advantages of Dean's? In this, to reduce the volume of the cancellous bone, so we are reducing the volume of the cancellous bone, maintaining the stress-bearing cortical bone. So basically, your cancellous bone, we are reducing. So your cortical bone, they are like, they resorb less and they have this more stress-bearing area. So they have more stress-bearing property. So in this case, in Dean's, we are removing the cancellous bone and not the cortical bone. The next, it does not require raising a mucoperiosteal flap. In this Dean's, we are not raising a mucoperiosteal flap. Then the next is, it is carried out immediately following the extraction. There is maintenance of the periosteal attachment of the labial plate of the bone. And because of that, there is decrease in the bone resorption. It has got the ability to reduce a buccal undercut. So as this is indicated in reduction of the overjet, that is your undercuts. So it has got the ability to reduce that undercut. Then overall less alveolar bone resorption than the use of buccal reduction technique. It has best long-term results. Then immediate dentures, it can be placed. So what are the principles of it? Biological principles. So first is, the prominence of the buccal and the labial margin, it is reduced to facilitate the reception of the dentures. Then the next is, the muscle attachment, they are undisturbed. So periosteum, it remains intact. The cortical plate, it is preserved with intact blood supply. It is starting off with the technique. First, the teeth, they are extracted starting from the canine to the incisors. As we know, we are extracting the posterior first. So we extract canines and then the incisor. After the extraction, we are removing the interdental bony septa with Rogers. So this is, we are removing the interdental bony septa with this Rogers forceps. Then a V-shaped excision or vertical cuts, they are placed on the bone. It is done in the labial cortical plate, which is distal and posterior to the canine eminence. So basically, you are making these two vertical cuts on the either side of canine. So over here, the teeth, they were extracted. Then you are doing this Dean's alveoloplasty, that is nothing but removing the genital bone septa. So after that, it looks like this. It looks like a single thing when you're comparing it with this first thing when multiple extraction were done. Then you are making these two vertical cuts on the either side of the canine. By this, the three sides of the labial cortex, they become free because you have given these two cuts, vertical cuts, and now this was the extracted thing. So it becomes freely movable, and it's like it becomes free and the labial cortex, it becomes freely movable graft, and it is attached only to the mucoperiosteal from which it receives its blood supply. Then with a periosteal elevator or osteotome, it is placed in the base of the canine socket. So you are placing periosteal elevator or osteotome in the canine socket bilaterally, and then you are fracturing it. Then this is the like the labial cortex, it is fractured labially. So now, as we have seen, it is freely movable. So what you're doing is you're like placing the osteotome or periosteal elevator in these two sides, and you are fracturing it. Then the finger pressure, it is applied on the labial cortical plate, which was collapsed towards the socket to compress it. Then the labial and the palatal plate, it will come into approximation with each other. And if there are any sharp margins which is present, then they are filed with the bone file, and after that sutures are given. So basically, first you're doing the extraction, then you're removing the interdental bone, then you're giving two vertical cuts. After that, you're fracturing it, and then you're compressing it. By this, your undercuts, it goes, and if there are cases, if you need to extract such multiple teeth, in that case, you're doing this densalveloplasty. So there was this Obwegisser modification for this intraseptal alveoloplasty. It was given in 1966. It is repositioning of both labial and the palatal cortices. It is used when your maxillary overjet is grossed and the inward compression of only labial cortex is not sufficient to reduce the overjet. So in Dehn's, we are compressing only the labial cortex. But in Obwegisser, what we do is we compress both labial and the palatal. So the technique is, first the extraction is done, then the interdental septal bone, it is cut with the help of rongeurs. Then what you're doing is an inverted cone, vulcanite burr, it is used to widen the socket. So now after that, you're using this burr and you're widening the socket. And then what you do is with a small disc or burr, horizontal cut, they are made at the base. So after that, what you're doing is you are making a horizontal cut at the base of the extraction socket in the labial and the palatal cortices. Then with these straight fissure burr, vertical cuts are made. So first you have made this horizontal cut, then you are making two vertical cuts, and then with digital pressure. So what you're doing, again, you're doing this. So vertical cuts, they are made bilaterally in the canine region in both palatal and labial cortices. Then labial and the palatal plates, they are compressed by digital pressure to approximate, and interrupted suturing is done, and their prefabricated splint is fitted into it. So basically, it's like you're giving this more horizontal cut, and in this you do the compression of both labial and the palatal cortices. So this is the Obwegisser modification for intraseptal alveoloplasty. And the next is the secondary alveoloplasty. So primary is when you're doing at the time of extraction. Secondary, when bone corrective surgery is done on the edentulous ridge for irregularity after the initiation of extraction socket healing, it is termed as secondary alveoloplasty. So basically, it's like when the healing process has started, and after that, you are doing the alveoloplasty, that is secondary. So basically, secondary is not you're doing. So basically, it is like you're not doing the alveoloplasty at the time of extraction. You're doing after the healing process. A sharp knife edge like edentulous ridge, it causes great denture irritation. So after your extraction socket, they have healed properly. So in some cases, you'll see a sharp knife edge which is present. So they're usually found in the anterior part of the mandible. So there is localized tenderness over such ridge on palpation, or if the patient is wearing a denture. So a ridge may also show irregular pattern, which is known as feather-edged ridge. So the technique for this, first we are making an incision, then we are raising a flap. And in this, releasing incision can be made on the labial and the buccal side to provide broad base to the flap. Then bony recontouring. So bony contouring is done with bone files, rondes or burr. Then the ridge, it is made free of sharp irregularities and is not aimed at perfectly smooth ridge. Digital palpation, it can be done. Then after satisfying result, they are obtained. You are irrigating it with saline to remove the debris, and then the flaps are closed with the help of sutures. So basically it's like same of what you're doing in primary alveoloplasty, but this is usually done after the healing of the socket or after the fabrication of the denture if the patient is coming with some irritation while wearing the dentures. So this was the secondary alveoloplasty, and this was it of this video. So I have explained about alveoloplasty in brief. In my further videos, I'll explain about the other procedures too, like phrenectomy, vestibuloplasty, and others. Thank you so much.